So it is my pleasure to introduce the great Maanit Madan, hailing from Atlanta, Georgia. He has built a series of incredible products, currently serving the poker community, but will soon serve social gaming of all kinds. I'll let Maanit take it from here and share more about his vision and what he's building. Thanks for coming on today, Maanit.
Yeah, thanks, Zach. It's an exciting way to introduce me. Glad, but I think Zach said it perfectly. We're kind of working on building kind of like the future of gaming, and right now we've been spending the last few years kind of revolutionizing how poker is played in a lot of card rooms and country clubs and places like that where they can leverage our technology. And today I kind of want to show you a glimpse into what we're doing for the future and going to a more mainstream market and a more social competitive socializing market. So I'll kind of go ahead and get started. Our product, it's game theory. And our company is called RF Labs. We've been building this RF poker technology for the last few years. And I don't know if some of you haven't seen kind of like the videos from the last Unbounded Perspectives that happened earlier this year. I definitely recommend going checking that out. I'll show some slides just to give some context before I do a demo of our technology. But yeah, go check that on their YouTube channel, like and subscribe. But let's go ahead and get started. So right now we're kind of in the state in the world where competition is slowly evolving. And in the last 20 years, it's had this rapid growth, really. Mostly from things like traditional games like chess, but also in sports like baseball and golf. And you can see here how technology's kind of come in and revolutionized how these games have been played. A game like chess that used to be played over the board with just two people has become a network of millions of players through chess.com, and they have ways to gamify the game itself. And that's something we've learned a lot from and are trying to kind of grow out into other games as well. And even sports like baseball have added this ability to add media and content to their live streaming and broadcasting. And that's kind of brought so many more viewers and eyes to the game. Also brought in secondary markets like fantasy gaming and drafting and all that stuff into the game of baseball. And you've seen this with all mainstream sports today. And finally, you see games like golf, which used to be for a certain niche and small audience of players, right? People who could afford to play at golf courses and spend the time out. And it slowly started to change. And now it's at a point where you have places like Top Golf, which is completely social atmospheres, still rooted in the game of golf, but now providing data analytics and also fun and exciting insights to make the game more exciting for everyday players. And the accessibility where before, if you couldn't afford to play golf or you couldn't afford lessons, now you can go and 80% of people who go to a place like Top Golf have never played in their life. So that's where we kind of came in and realized that there's the game of poker had so much growth in the early 2000s. And now it has a second boom that's going on the last few years because of live streaming and because of this content creation network that's taking place online and in live settings. But we realized that with millions of hands being played every single day in poker, not a single one is being recorded and no insights are being given to players. And that was the first problem we realized, but that kind of grew out into realizing that when you do give these insights to players, that builds a whole new market altogether. And that's kind of where we are. So if you kind of look at the poker market, if you're not familiar with it, we kind of start off with this streaming poker, which is content creation in these card rooms where every card room might have one table that they use to market to other players, show videos of people playing. You can see the cards on the live stream on YouTube. And that's like a small market, but that's where our technology kind of came in and was able to show that, okay, we can completely revolutionize how streaming is doing. And I'm going to show you how we did that in a little later. But from there, you kind of grow into competitive poker, which is card rooms, tournaments, leagues. And that's kind of where we are right now. But our next step is saying, how can we go into the mainstream audience with social poker and competitive socializing and go into this multi-billion dollar market of everyday people who just want to go over a weekend and play a game, but don't want to worry about money or the transactions that take place, but more of just having fun with their friends or getting better at the game and trying to learn more on how to be a better player, right? So that's kind of the market we're at right now and what we're addressing. And that's kind of where game theory comes in. So RF poker, what we've been building for the last few years has fallen under this competitive side, but now we're kind of looking at the social side. And to get a better understanding of our product, there's two aspects of it, really. There's the mobile side, which is the app that's provided to the players, the insides, the gamification of the game. And then the RF Cloud, which is our platform that allows you to do things like live streaming, increase security, receive insights to bring more players to your card rooms. And we took this technology that we spent so much time developing with our physical tables, physical chips and cards that have these RFID tags embedded in them. And we're now bringing that to the social audience. So here's a little video of one of our location game theory that we recently opened.
Deliver.
So a lot happened in that video, but I'll kind of go through now kind of what this is, right? So you saw the competitive side and how that technology is being used for our app and live streaming, but game theory is a completely reinvented arcade, and we're using all this technology to kind of take that audience of people who have either never played poker before or have played once in a while at home with friends and show them how you can have a really fun and entertaining experience while also focusing on the competitiveness on the game and not on the money side or trying to win something off other players. So it's kind of like a positive sum experience we look at for a zero sum game. And there are multiple things that create this, right? There's the actual physical experience, the tables, chips, cards, feeling like a normal gameplay with lights and cameras everywhere. But there's also the post-mortem of the game, right? The app that shows you how you're ranking amongst other players, how you played, and an actual way to show what you did right or wrong, right? And with all the software, we're kind of using the back end with the TV screens, with the commentary system, with the live streaming, plus the app for the players, we can kind of put that together and reinvent what it means to be kind of like an arcade or a social gaming setting, right? And our goal is to expand this to other games as well. So I'm going to kind of now go into and show you a demo of the digital layer of our whole system, right? So you kind of saw a video of how it looks on the hardware side with the chips, cards, the tables, but what does it kind of look like to a player once they've played in our system? So we'll switch around over here. You guys should be able to see. This is the Game Theory app, and this is the first time we're actually demoing it outside of the players who've used this. We have about, I think, 93 players in our Game Theory location who've played there the last few months and had the ability to kind of use this app. And obviously, I haven't played, so I'm going to show you. Here's Manish's account. So when you open the app, you kind of first see this score over here, right? The 915 RF score. This is kind of the core of everything you will see throughout the app today. We realized when we were redesigning our app that what we were providing to players, which initially was just insights and analytics, needed to be kind of explained in a more subjective way where they could look at it and say, how can I get better or worse without looking at results, right? And this is something that we kind of saw from other traditional games like chess, where you have your Elo score, and that showed you how good or bad of a chess player you are and how you can improve over time. But nothing like that existed for poker, because in a game like poker, there's so much variance and luck that comes into play. So we said, how can we go and take that data that we have about how well you played, how lucky you got, and kind of show you what you're actually doing right or wrong, right? So we'll jump into this first and see. When you click on your RF score, what does that mean, right? So we break it down into four factors, and this is kind of an explanation here of how the score is calculated. You have how balanced you are as a player, how aggressive you are, how consistent you are, and your variance, how lucky or unlucky are you getting, right?
And Matt, let's just slow down here for the non-poker players on this call. So like, what would the equivalent of this be for maybe something that more people here play, like soccer or tennis?
Sure. Yeah. I think in a lot of these games, whether you win or lose is enough to kind of show how good you are as a player, right? If you're a soccer player, I mean, in soccer, they have ratings at the highest level, right? If you look at FIFA scores or FIFA ratings, each player kind of has that number that shows how their attack is, how their defense is, how their stamina is, right? And that's kind of different aspects of you as an athlete and how that affects your gameplay and how that affects your results, which takes away the account of, okay, were you on a bad team or did you get unlucky because you were playing against a good team, right? So we're kind of doing that same thing here where we're kind of seeing, okay, this is how you played minus all the other factors that were out of your control, really, right? And people can look at that and say, okay, now I can make actual decisions to play better. Like a soccer player can look at their stamina and see, maybe I should be working on that and work on my cardio rather than working on my skill or my defense, right? And that's kind of what this part of the app is about.
Cool.
Yeah. So when you go into like these four scores, and this is kind of dumbing it down to the basic structure, and we kind of look at, you said soccer, tennis, but another thing that we kind of really like to mimic off of is a lot of sleep tracking or health tracking apps, because that's a situation where there's so much data being involved, but it's really hard to kind of explain to a person simply what they should be doing differently, right? And we're called game theory, but if you look at in the health side, if you look at something like Orange Theory, right, you go in person, they didn't want to show publicly your information on what your weight is or how fast you are and things like that. So they came up with this concept of the orange line, and you just have to get your heart rate above this orange line. And everyone's orange line will be different, but the goal is to kind of subjectively show that this is where you're supposed to be. And we're doing the same thing here, where this is RF score is kind of what you're supposed to do, minus how many tournaments you won or how many hands you won or lost. That none of that really matters here, right? It's more of how are you playing on a hand-by-hand basis and what is your macro skill like? So these four factors here kind of come together and are multiplied by a time factor, which shows you how long you've played for, how many people you've played against, and that kind of tells you how the score is kind of adjusted, right? And you can go even further into details, and this is where you get into the nitty-gritties of what exactly does that mean, right? And one thing when you're designing this app is to make sure that everything in the app is clickable. From this word VPIP over here, if you click it, it tells you an exact definition of what it is, and you can learn more about it using our AI, which I'll get into later. But we can have your VPIP, how many times you bluffed, and different range charts that show, okay, this is from different positions, from different types of things I did, what kind of cards did I play with. And to most players, this is just a jumble of rectangles, right? And you don't really know what's going on, or squares. But we kind of look at that and say, how can we kind of break this down to anyone, right? And you can see the different cards that you've played with and how many times you played it, what percentage of the time. And we're adding optimal charts as well. So you can compare this to an actual coach's charts and say, okay, this is what I have. This is what they recommend. And how should I change my chart to look more like that, right? So kind of bridging the gap between what are you actually doing and what can you actually make changes to make your gameplay better.
What are some of the other games kind of on the horizon? I know you're going to be focusing on poker for kind of the near to medium term, but after, you know, this is ubiquitously used across card rooms, casinos, and amongst players, what are some of the other games that lend themselves naturally to this technology like game theory?
I'll give two examples, and these are pretty extreme examples on either side. So just to give you an example of how what the variety will look like. The one that we're looking at next is really just chess, because that's very similar to poker in a way. There are game theory optimal strategies to play chess. It's a little more obvious than poker, because in chess there's a right move and it's you have all the information. In poker, it's a game of where you don't have that much information because the other person, you can't see their cards, of course. But in chess, you can. And that allows us to kind of go even further into the data and simplify it. Something like what chess.com's done before a live setting. And in chess, it's more about less about the data and analytics we show in the app and more of the real physical setting of how can we take elementary school chess club and bring those 20 kids instead of sitting in their cafeteria and playing chess, come to a game theory location and play and use this insights to get better, right? I grew up playing chess at a very competitive level. And I saw that when in high schools and elementary schools, how that's kind of taught is very different than what it could be taught with this technology, right? And the same goes from a social setting where these traditional games are kind of dying away because kids aren't enjoying this anymore, right? You're on your phone. You don't want to go into this physical space. Now, if we can make it more entertaining through live streaming, through these clips that you can post on social media, through gamifying your score against your friends, that's all going to happen. So one example is chess. Another extreme is something like karting, racing, right? And I know it sounds crazy. Like this is mind games, table games. Like why would you get into something so physical like karting? But it's to kind of show that once you put data and drive these games with data, it can become way more entertaining, right? So we've talked to a lot of racers, and I've had some experience in the past doing karting also at a competitive level. And you kind of can see when you can see in your app how you took a chicane, how you turned your speed at different when you're braking, right? And look at a map. And even during the game in real time, you saw those TV screens while people are playing poker. It shows you what action's going on while you're karting. If the cart has a screen on it and can show you where your the person behind you is, how far they are, and add this data to make the experience more exciting. There's so much more we could do that takes that traditional game, which you'll really see in cities anymore, right? You see these electric carts and these arcades. We can completely change that way, make it way more competitive and bring players into a scene kind of like what they do in Formula One today, right? So those are two extremely different examples, but both of them are using data and insights to completely change what it means to compete at these levels.
Awesome.
Yeah. So kind of back to this, I think that over here, you've kind of seen balance, and we do the same thing with all these screens, right? You can see the aggression, and you can see how these different values and numbers are for you, and you can see the recommended range in the middle of the blue line and where your dot is currently. And in the end, if you don't know what any of these means, the goal is to kind of look at this and quickly understand what these words mean and get up to speed, right? By just clicking on one of these, understanding what is a 3-bet or a C-bet, stuff like that, right? And being able to go and see what specific hands did that affect. So that's kind of where these stats come into play. And that's what players are using today to improve their game. And in games like chess and sports like karting or soccer, having these kind of numbers and values available that were only recently available to a very professional level can now be democratized and be available to anyone who comes and plays at a location, right? And that's kind of the goal here. So that's more on the RF score. Kind of go into more of the details of what our app provides to the players on a game-to-game basis. You can see here, Manish has played many games in the last few months. Let's go into this one where he got 0 points, game number 6, right? And when you click on this, you can see more details about this exact session. He played on June 20th at the game theory location. His score went down by 30. It went from 945 to 915. He was 22nd of 31 players, and he got 0 points. So you can kind of quickly see, okay, here's how I perform this game. Here's how each of my individual scores are affected. And now let's get into the actual details of the session. And when you're looking at this, I think like Zach was bringing up, I think it helps to kind of think about how would this look like for other games as well, right? And I think this is where we kind of focus on making it as adaptable as possible. Things like your player card, your live streams, your hand details can be adapted to other things as well, right? With chess, you can see every move. With things like bowling, you can see every shot that you take, right? So all that kind of comes into play here. And you can see over here. So the first thing is after the session's over, Manish can look at his player card and it can show you, okay, this is how you played. This is how he played 39 hands. He won 6 of them. He can see how lucky or unlucky he got and share this or save this and then send it to friends later, right? So that kind of brings in the gamification. We see people posting this on Facebook after every single game and everyone receives their player card, and that kind of brings people into the location. And the same thing goes for the live streams. After the game, you can go and see, okay, here are the 3 tables I played on. Go ahead and click on one of them, and don't know if it's going to load, but you can kind of scrub through and see that this is kind of the live stream. This is a 4-hour long stream of everyone playing, and you can go through and see every single hand that was played, who was I playing against, the video footage of their camera, and you can go ahead and share the link or even watch on YouTube. So this has become a great way for players to kind of come through the door and see, have an experience that they never had before. And kind of going back, imagine if you're sitting there and after you finished a race at go-karting, you can kind of go back and see, okay, this is my turn. This is how I took the turn. And you can actually see a video footage of it, right? Kind of like you can see here with the dealer and you saw in the video before, you can see where the dealer button was, who plays chips. You can look for poker face, right? See how people are reacting to when you had certain cards and kind of learn from that, right? And it's also more entertaining because you can now go and share one of these clips with your friends and say, look how I won this hand, right? So that's the live streaming aspect. And now we can go kind of directly into the actual hand details. And for most of you, if you've never played before, never seen before, this might be a lot of jumble of just numbers and cards to you. And that's kind of something we're working on. It's kind of showing, and you'll see with the stars on the right side, how does that hand or how did that hand really affect my gameplay, right? These 1-star hands will show you there's a 3-star hand here. This is kind of interesting. So it's going to this 3-star hand. And what does that mean? Well, that's the excitement rating. That's how exciting that hand was for me, right? And this is where we're kind of using AI to kind of drive a lot of the insights in our app. We're using these kind of LLMs to kind of say, here's all the history of this hand. How would you rate this hand? Or what would you think of this hand? And we're right now fine tuning that data as well. I'll get into that in a bit. But when you open the hand, you can kind of see, okay, here's some general stats like you saw before. Over here, this person won a cooler. That means they got super lucky on the hand and beat someone like that. But that's probably why it was a 3-star hand. Here's how many chips you won in this hand. And you can go in a little further and see, okay, here are the players I was playing against, right? This is the actions that took place. You can go through and see every single decision that was made, what their stack size was, what their bet was, what the cards that came out were. And then go all the way to the end and actually go back and see, okay, what did they actually have? And this is something you can't do today in a live setting. You can't go back and review what did that player actually have at the end, right? And how did the decision I made affect my results here? And in this case, Manish won a big hand. He hit a flush. You can see the 5 cards he had, and you can see who else he beat. And that's just a general, very basic kind of understanding and stats of the game. And this is what we've been showing for years to like our customers. But what we're doing is now taking one step further and saying, if you don't understand what any of this means, well, what do you do with that? Well, you can go ahead and ask RF here. And what that'll do is that'll kind of ask this AI to go and give you a full analysis on your hand, right? It'll tell you from every single street, this is what happened. At preflop, you called a raise, and this is the position you were in. These are the cards you had. It was reasonable. On the flop, this card came out. You hit the nut flush. That means you kind of need to slow play this and kind of extract as much value as possible. And here are the cards that came out after that. So you can kind of see that the AI is going through and giving this analysis on a text basis. And it tells you in the end, you played this hand very well. You made good decisions. That's great. But to most players, you might not understand what some of these words mean, right? So you can go in and ask, for example, what does it mean to raise, right? And ask for a follow-up question, right? And it'll basically go through, analyze kind of what you asked and the previous question and kind of give you this feedback. So you can have this conversation now with what does risk premium mean? What does a raise mean, right? And different terms, but also go and say, how did I use this in this hand or what could I have done differently? This is kind of like the preliminary phase of our AI, and this is kind of how we're getting started with just this chat interface. But our goal is to kind of take this and integrate it into the app. And you can see here how this is just for hand 4, but when you go back, things like our excitement rating, right? That's basically using AI in a way that's not a chat interface, but it's still giving the player a data point that they could use that can't be just done by adding a weighted sum of numbers. You have to actually go through and collect tons and tons of data, and that can only be done by large models like this. And the next step is kind of to take that and tune it even further and train it on actual data. For example, your own hand histories, right? This is just one hand. Can we train it on all your hands and basically go back and say, hey, what have I done well this week? And it'll tell you from the last week, every single hand you played, and here are the top five hands you played. And we're kind of working on that right now. And that's the last step before we publicly release this app, is to take that trained and fine-tuned data and push it back to players. So that's all the data analytics insight side to improving your gameplay. And that's kind of what's been working for us for the last few months. But to go back into what we started off with, right? It's the aspect of gamifying the game and making the game more exciting for players at a social level. Just to add some context, when you come to a game theory location and play these games, you're not playing for actual money. You can come and play for free. You get free chips. Or you can spend money on food and drinks. And obviously that helps the restaurant generate revenue. But in the end, what's really happening is you're winning prizes for playing and improving your gameplay, right? We have point system, and the point system you can kind of see here is a leaderboard. We have an RF score leaderboard, but also based on how you played, right? So you can see Sandra over here. She's won most tournaments and she gets points. And at the end, she'll have a championship event where you can kind of win more prizes, right? And that's kind of how the business runs, where we tie up with these restaurants, put our tables there on days where they don't have that many people coming in. And now they have 30 people showing up to play poker, spending X amount of money on food and drinks and generating revenue on Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, when these bars and restaurants might not have that, right? So that model is kind of what takes place here, and that also helps the players. So our goal is to kind of expand that and build our own franchise and build these player networks of thousands or millions of players across the world, where if you're in different game theory locations, you can also be on these leaderboards and fight for the top 10, right? And the same goes for the RF score, where maybe I got unlucky and I've not been playing that well, where you can see here that Sonia is not in even the top five for points, but she played so well that her RF score is number one, and you can even go back and see, okay, how is she playing? This is her RF score here. Here are her sub scores, and I can go ahead and give her a follow, right? And then I'll get notified every time she plays a tournament or wins a tournament. I'll see a notification saying, hey, Sonia won. You should have been there today. Come back next week to kind of dethrone her, right? So this is kind of the gamification of the app, and this is what we're doing to kind of take it a step further. You can even go in and see our upcoming events here. This is game 7, which is actually tonight, 7:30. If any of you are in Atlanta, please show up. If you're not, we're just a flight away. So this is kind of where you can come in, register to play, and see kind of what the structure is of the gameplay, of the blind levels. And we're actually using this with card rooms as well, where now when they run games, they can show their events, and it becomes a great marketing tool, where if I open the app, I can see in my area where the different places games are going on, and how can I join those games and improve my game through that. So overall, that kind of summarizes everything on the game theory app. It shows you kind of what we've been working on, what we're putting out to players. I think the score, the stats, the gamification is kind of what gives us our advantage today, especially with being in a live hardware setting. But what's going to drive improvement is the network of players and the AI that kind of tells them how to improve their game and get better. And we're continuously adding features, tools, and are planning to release this publicly in around end of August or early September. Yeah, that's pretty much it for me.
Well, thank you, Maanit.
Yeah.
A lot of information there. So, you know, I have, of course, a bunch of questions for you, but as always in the Unbounded Perspectives format, want to give some space for our guests to chime in with any questions. So any folks here have questions of any kind for Maanit about game theory or just generally what he's building with RF Labs?
I'll kick us off with one that I put in the chat. I'm curious about, I know poker players are somewhat private of what their hands are. And when you're showing, you know, kind of the review of the hands played, you could see all the cards from your opponent's hands. Do they have to permission that to the app, or is that just kind of by default? Once a game is over, you can see what hands everyone had that you played against?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So currently we have two different ways the hands show up, right? And I think just to show what you're talking about here. To players today, the live stream, the hands only show up automatically if they're playing on the live stream. And you can see here where it says live streamed, other players' cards are shown below 30 minutes after the stream ends. So since these players are opting in to play on a table that there is going to be live streamed and people can watch publicly on YouTube, we show the hands anyway, because those hands are going to be there if you go watch the video. Now, we also have some tables which are not live streamed, right? And these tables are used just as a RFID table for players to improve their gameplay. In that case, currently you can only see your own hand, right? You can see what you had, but not what other people had. And our goal, and I talked about this a little bit when at the conference in Austin, right? But our goal is to kind of say, how can we even gamify that aspect, right? Can you go in and see if I'm Manish and I have threes over here, can I go to Nim and hit a button that says request to see hand? And Nim can say, sure, I'll request to see your hand. Or maybe you do a transaction of 20 cents for me to see your hand and you can see my hand, right? So that kind of transaction that can happen only throughout our game. And this is kind of a trustworthy source, right? Right now, even partnering with third-party companies that do forms of kind of staking and other things to basically show that you can now use our platform to someone at home who you trust can track your stack size and your cards and see like your coach and also support you or invest in your gameplay, right? And that's another kind of use case here, but it's obviously all private, secure, and only available to yourself in case it's live streamed, anyone can see it.
Awesome. That you actually kind of touched on the second question that I had about staking. As someone who has staked players before, I'm kind of like anxiously waiting for the update in like a group chat afterwards. So it'd be awesome to have, you know, kind of live intel.
Who have you staked, Dave?
Jack.
Yeah.
Good choice. Good choice. But I think that, yeah, no, I think you're completely right. I don't know how much publicly I can say about kind of what we're working on right now, but we are kind of looking into that and building a product, and it's going to be a pilot's going to be out soon in a card room in Texas to run that. And I hopefully that'll kind of drive through tables across the entire US aside from just game theory tables.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Well, so just tell us more about how you came up with the idea for game theory. Because so Unbounded Capital invested in your company, you know, under a year ago now. And when we invested, game theory wasn't even an idea that you had. And in what seems like an insanely fast amount of time, this went from, oh, I have this cool idea, I think earlier this year, to you have, you know, a full-blown product that isn't just, you know, top of class for poker, but there's nothing like this to my knowledge for social gaming of any kind. So would love to hear what that journey was like and how you went from the insights of the RF poker table to this, you know, game theory.
Yeah. So let me kind of put this back over here because I think this will help get an understanding. But from the beginning, and I think even last year, when I first talked to you, Zach, we were showing this page, right? And this has kind of been kind of our North Star the whole time, where in terms of just the poker audience, our goal has always been to kind of build a product that can be used by anyone who loves poker, right? And whether that's in their basement at home on a dining table or at a card room, or even at a bowling alley or an arcade. And initially we were thinking of going to that arcade type of market, right? But earlier this year, we were working with card rooms, we were testing our product out. And I started to realize this kind of, the product wasn't directly transferable in a way where if you have a card room using our app and using a table, this idea, like kind of what Dave brought up with security, ends up being a big thing with the live streaming and with all these insights and stuff like that. The players look at it very differently when you've been playing poker for 20 years versus someone who's played for the first time. And I stumbled across this whole market of players under what's called bar poker, right? And to kind of give some context, right? There's poker's been played in different situations, right? You have about 120 million people worldwide who've ever played poker, whether if that's at home or on an iPhone app for free. You have about 5 to 6 million people who play in card rooms, casinos, who play on about 50 million who play online on actual websites, right? So there's different places you can play poker. And another one of these locations was what's called bar or tavern poker, right? And these are in small cities where you have people coming every day to these restaurants where, let's say we have a restaurant on a Monday night, which doesn't really get that much people coming in through the door, but they have to have staff sitting there. They have to have their food running, their kitchen running. And that ends up being a huge cost to them, but they're not generating that much revenue. They basically tie up with one of these bar leagues and say, okay, put in these 5 tabletops, bring in 50 players, and those 50 players will come play poker and they'll be required to spend $30 on food to get more chips, right? So they can come play for free, but if they spend $30 on food, they'll get extra chips to play with. And that creates this competitive environment where now you have points, you have people buying chips from food, they're coming in and having a great time just eating food, dinner with their friends and family and playing, but they're also getting these points and trying to go for the championships. And at the end of the championship event, whoever wins gets a free ticket to play at the World Series main event in Vegas, right? So this whole model was super interesting to me because I saw that here's an audience and we tied up with the league called Atlanta Poker Club, right? We're based in Atlanta and they have over 60 locations playing every single week. So you have on any given day, thousands of people across the whole state coming to these restaurants and playing poker for free. And I saw that model and I said, can we bring our technology here, right? And can that be our door into social poker the same way live streaming was our door into competitive poker? And that was kind of the talk I had with our team early in January, actually this year. And I said, we want to kind of go into bar poker and use that as our way to jump into the social arcade, right? And kind of package that bar poker idea and make it mainstream and make it so anyone can play it. And then grow that same idea into every other game. Because I could imagine a bar chess and I can imagine a bar go-karting, right? But can we do that in our own location, not make it this rundown, sketchy bar, but this really high-end experience and really high-quality, fun, entertaining, family-friendly experience, right? So that's when we kind of thought of game theory, and we took kind of ideas of what we had in the past with plus ideas, like I said, with fitness centers and with health tracking apps and with chess and soccer and all these things, and put it all together and said, let's find a restaurant that's not currently running bar poker, a really high-end restaurant. So we found a Firefly Bar and Grill here in Alpharetta, Georgia, really close to me, and said, hey, we want to just put three tables here in the back. We're going to set up the cameras, lights, all that stuff for you. You'll just give us this event space and we'll bring in 50 people every single day, we promise, right? And they kind of said, okay, if you bring in 50 people every day and they're spending all this money at this restaurant that's about to shut down, we'll kind of obviously take in all these people. And in return, they just let us use the space, let us connect our computers and all that stuff in the back. And that's kind of how that room came to be. That you saw in this video here. Let me kind of mute it and find a spot where you can see the room. But you can see these tables. We put three of these tables. We put up 10 TVs, all these cameras, and all this happened probably within the span of, I think, 10 days. Because we've had so much experience doing these in card rooms. I knew that here's how the table should be placed. Here's where the lights should be. You can see this camera grid up here. It's pretty low quality, but we have about 18 cameras set up across the room, all tied up into the roof. And that was just for our proof of concept. Our goal now is, can we do this in 100 different locations? And can we make these tables more scalable? We're looking at 360 degree cameras to be mounted on the table instead of this huge camera rig. And that'll allow you to kind of put 20 tables in the location without any extra cost. So that's kind of a long answer to show you that this is the whole process we've been through. And we opened the location in around late March. March 30th was our first game. We started with one game a week, went to two games a week. Now we're doing three games a week. And by the end of August, we plan to be running a game every single day there, and getting players in every single day and showing that this model works. And now we want to open our own actual location and franchise that out to the world.
Awesome. When one location?
What are you asking, when's the first location?
Yeah. When do you think it's going to happen? And
I think right now we're kind of in Atlanta. That's something that we're currently discussing. It's a kind of a mixture of raising another round of money. Also kind of figuring out how can we finish kind of getting the product to a point where it can be used by anyone. Right now, there's a lot of features we want to add where if you're new to the game, you can have like an assistance feature where it'll show you, here's your cards, here's where you can get better. Here's what this means, right? You have straight, you have flush, very basic things.
Yeah.
I think by the end of August, we should have all that ready and start scouting for a location. We're kind of deciding between Atlanta, Austin, or the Bay Area. Those are like our three areas right now we're kind of thinking of in terms of just our team being there, growing the team, and also building locations. So I think that's a work in progress, but we'll keep everyone here updated for sure.
Cool. I'm sure we'll talk offline about, you know, lots of pros to all the different locations you're considering.
For sure. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So Maanit, can you share whatever you're comfortable sharing that is, you know, public as we record these, kind of what your current, you know, revenue is and what your projections are? Got a question from Kurt Overly here.
Sure. Yeah. So right now we have kind of two parts of the business, right? One is the table sales that we've kind of been doing over the last year. Give some context. We started selling these tables to card rooms almost about a year ago, a little less than a year ago. And these tables we sell for about $10,000 per table with a $300 per month subscription. At the time, our pricing was a little different, but for the last few months, that's been our pricing. And we also have a $20,000 option where you don't pay $300 per month for the first 3 years. And that's what you can do to get one of these live streaming tables in your room. And for the last year, we've been selling one table to every single room because they only need one live streaming table. We only have one location that has multiple tables, but we've sold, we're about to hit 20 tables actually by the end of this month. In the last year, we were selling one table a month. And for the last 3 months, we've been selling 2 to 3 tables a month.
And you've been backordered basically since you went live, right?
Yeah. So for sure. Yeah. We opened a wait list up, back in October, I think. And that wait list was basically to see what card rooms are actually interested. And we got this huge list of card rooms of we want a table. And we could only do one table a month, and we were actually losing money on every table. So we would build a table for about $13,000 at the time, and sell it for $10,000. Or actually that time we were selling for $7,500. So we were losing money per table. We needed a lot of capital at the time. We were raising a round of funding back then. And we were deploying one table a month. We had sold or had a long wait list by then. And that was up until about March this year. We said we're going to stop selling these tables, and we spent a month redesigning our hardware with this new manufacturer that would actually kind of allow us to not lose money on each of the tables and actually be slightly profitable or break even when we sell the table and then make it back through the subscription. And that happened since April. We've been doing that. And since we've been working with this new manufacturer and we've had the capital to kind of order 10 tables at a time of parts, we've been able to deploy about three tables a month. We're currently
still... When do you anticipate getting through the back orders, or maybe never? Just
I think right now we're always going to be ahead in terms of sales. We kind of got through that initial wait list. About last month, we kind of finished through that initial wait list, but we had more people kind of join in. And now we have, I'm talking to basically another card room every single week at this point, and setting dates on when you can get the table, when you can get the cards, and the chips are extremely back ordered still for a few months. So
yeah,
we're kind of still working through that, but in the end, we realized that we're not able to test our app to the same level because hardware is such a big blockade, and being able to ship these tables. We shipped our first one to Toronto 2 weeks ago, and that was the first one outside the US. And just that whole process of shipping one of these massive 400-pound tables, 10 by 5 feet, to Toronto and even other locations ends up being a huge hassle right now for a small company like us. So we're still figuring out the logistics of that. And I think we're going to get pretty good at that by the end of this year. And the goal is to kind of just keep rapidly increasing those and getting users. But that's why game theory was a great way for, not even as a way to gain traction and a new business model, but it's also just a great way for us to test out our features in our app without that limitation of trying to find new rooms and new customers. Yeah.
Yeah. What do you project in terms of revenue for, the RF tables versus game theory, say in, 6 or 12 months from now?
I think this year alone with RF tables, we should be good to be on track to hit over $300,000 in revenue just through the table sales. Now, obviously the app and the game theory right now, we're not monetizing our app at game theory or any of these locations, right? And the goal is to kind of start doing that by season 2. In game theory, we run every season ends in the season ends in August, and that's why it kind of ends up lining up pretty well with our development time. But season 2 is kind of when we have the app ready, and September 1st, we're going to start using that. And our plan is to start monetizing our app over there, have a subscription, have tokens that you can use to ask questions from the AI and stuff like that. And I think we've gotten really positive feedback from the players, and I think we'll generate a lot of value from that. And then the second thing is, I think from this whole model that we're currently looking into of franchising out the location, right? When we build our first location, the restaurant alone is generating enough revenue and profits. Actually, it's extremely high margins to run the whole business, right? Of having a location, creating capital. And if we were to franchise out this technology, there are a lot of people who'd want to, instead of opening a restaurant, which will maybe cost you $1 million to kind of build and very struggle to bring people through the door, or franchising out Topgolf, which would cost you $10 to $50 million to franchise and takes 2 to 3 years to make back the money. This is kind of a great middle ground where at a very low capital cost of maybe like $1 million, you can open a full location. You're guaranteed to get players through the door using our technology and through our marketing, right? And the cost and the value that you get from players requiring to order food and drinks and players having to use our app subscription and membership, all that is so much higher than the value you'll generate from all these other types of franchises like bowling alleys and Topgolfs, that this might just be the perfect kind of franchise option for a lot of people. And that's kind of the model we're looking at right now. And hopefully by the end of the year, we can prove that and put that out in the market.
Cool. Thank you for the comprehensive explanation.
Yeah.
Thank you, Kurt.
Yeah, and also all this information is kind of on our website, rfpoker.com. We are right now about to put out a game theory website in the next coming weeks. So, but the rfpoker.com, we're pretty transparent.
What domain did you get for that?
Right now we have gametheory.social. We're trying to still figure out the SEO and get another domain. It took us a while to get rfpoker.com as well, but we're working on that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Dave, it looks like you have a question.
I do have a question, yeah. So, in conjunction with the rise of Topgolf and kind of these like gamified analytics type experiences, we also have an explosion in online sports betting and especially real-time betting. And so I'm wondering, one, currently, is there betting on poker in like the sports betting category? And do you see that as a potential revenue stream in the future, as you're going to have a lot more kind of, you know, data and analytics on the players to make real-time betting as someone watching a poker live stream perhaps more interesting? Have you thought about that as a future path for RF?
Yeah, we've talked a lot about this, especially because not necessarily betting, but like we said before, staking ends up being a very big market, specifically in poker, because in a lot of other games, if you're playing a tournament, you don't really, it's not very common for an everyday person to stake someone to play a tennis tournament or a chess tournament, right? But in a poker tournament, anyone can go play, anyone can win in the end, right? So it's staking ends up being a much larger market for poker than any of the other games. When it comes to betting, I think there's starting to be things out there that can do betting or side betting or secondary markets for poker. We haven't gone much into it because I think the cost to put one of these out and the regulations and all the stuff you have to fight ends up being, and we've also noticed with the casino industry, right? Even putting our tables in a casino in Vegas is much, much harder and a lot more cost intensive than putting it in a card room or a country club in Texas, right? And the market in Texas right now is so much bigger. And that's kind of when we saw this, we're like, this market's bigger, it's easier to put in there, and it's a lot more, a lot less gambling going on because there's a lot of these tournaments running. So it ends up being this great spot for us to kind of help players improve their game. So in terms of betting, I think it's a similar situation, and we haven't spent much time looking into it. I do think that in the long run, if there are other companies that are doing this, they can probably talk to us and figure out a way to maybe build some type of partnership. But or maybe if we can kind of see that market being really valuable and to us in the long run, we'd get into it. But as of now, we're not really working on that.
Cool.
I was also going to add, I think in terms of if you look at like the trajectory that game theory is kind of going in, and our ability to build a business model off of something that's kind of more on the reason why we love this kind of like social competitive side is because we're also promoting that between like through other games, and to you can kind of imagine this being like a very family friendly experience, right? And I think that a lot of people might not agree, but what we've kind of seen is that we can generate similar types of revenue and create business models that are as lucrative, but through a very better morally situation, more competitive and social situation to a larger audience and larger market, which you might not do through casino security or through online betting and all these other things that might involve casinos and gambling. So we kind of see that being a way better vision and mission for us as a team, and it's a lot easier to hire great people to kind of build that kind of product out.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thank you everyone for joining the Unbounded Perspectives webinar today. You'll be able to catch Maanit at the Unbounded Capital Summit in New York City on September 21st to do a demo of the latest game theory app. Thank you everyone so much for joining, and have a great rest of your day.